Why will it benefit the country, frankly, to join the ICC? I've asked Senator Risa Ontiveros this same question. You have the United States, who isn't even a member of the ICC. When the ICC wanted to investigate U.S. soldiers, how they behaved in Afghanistan, the United States said, stop, you have no jurisdiction. Our courts are working.
Yes. That's true. And therefore,
so why do we have, what's the benefit? Why do we have to join the ICC? Our courts have also technically convicted. You have two presidents.
Technically, Karen, we don't have to join the ICC because the matter of respect for human rights is recognized in our constitution and our existing laws. We recognize the principles in the international law of respect for human rights. We are the only country with a commission on human rights embedded in the constitution, created by the constitution. So if you are going to be strict about it, we do not need to join the ICC, but observance of principles of human rights is a universally accepted principle in international law, where we are members of various treaties that require respect for human rights. And with this, we can allow, and there is nothing illegal about allowing the ICC investigators to see what is the situation. You know, we cannot live in isolation. This is the reality worldwide.
But isn't this also a matter of sovereignty?
Well,
our courts are working.
Well, you know, Karen, the matter of sovereignty, we surrendered that in effect when we joined international bodies. Because remember that treaties are part of the law of the land. And by the concurrence of the ratification of the treaty becomes part of the law of the land that's provided for in the constitution. So I really could not understand why the insistence on Senate concurrence, when the president can do it as he has done it in the past without Senate concurrence, insofar as accession to the treaty is concerned.
Okay. Now, do you believe you have some observers who've questioned the timing and have said this is essentially being used to silence Vice President Sara Duterte or affect her number in the polls? There are some that are saying this is a political move. What are your thoughts?
I would rather stick to what the legal issues are, because there should be nothing political here. Respect for human rights is universal. That we answer in a community of nations to the community of nations insofar as universal concurrence with human rights principles. This is even embodied in our constitution. And we have existing laws which require us to respect human rights. So the matter of whether or not it's politics, it's, to me, that's outside the debate insofar as the legalities are concerned.
Okay.
You know, you can always have your own political conclusions, but it doesn't matter. The law to me is clear.
Okay. Now, Senator, you have, for example, Vladimir Putin. The ICC's came out with a decision, and yet he still leads his own country. Some have questioned the effectivity, the power, the real influence of the ICC. What can they really do? They can't arrest him. He's still there.
So
let's say hypothetically, former President Duterte hypothetically does get convicted. Of course, this is still, it's still talk of a preliminary investigation. We're not even close to the trial itself. But let's move forward. Will it matter?
So if we're saying that the ICC is ineffective, you cited President Putin. If the ICC is ineffective, so why can we not let the investigators come in consistent with our adherence to the principles of respect for human rights? Whether or not the cooperation will be there is a matter for the president to decide. But the issue of whether or not the ICC investigators should come in, to me, is not no longer an issue. First, the president has that power. If he decides to allow them, no one can question that. That's his prerogative. If he decides not to allow them, Again, nobody can question that because the Supreme Court even recognized that. Remember that in the Rome, in the ratification of the Rome Statute, the Senate did not say that withdrawal should be with the concurrence of the Senate. So that's why we lost the case in the Supreme Court. But with that case in the Supreme Court, having been lost in every ratification of the treaty after that, I inserted the clause which would require Senate concurrence in the withdrawal from the treaty which we have ratified. So that is the case. That is the situation today, Karen.
Okay, just two more questions here. I interviewed Attorney Conti the other day, and she said that while Philippine courts are working, the two presidents essentially that faced judgment were charges of plunder. And she said this is crimes against humanity. So it embodies a much larger crime. If I were to ask you, Senator, do you believe former President Duterte's policies against drugs, do you believe that it constitutes a crime against humanity?
That is a legal conclusion that you seek to draw from me, and I will not do that unless I have possession of the facts. We are just limiting our debate as to whether or not the president can allow the ICC investigators to come in and investigate allegations of crimes against humanity. That is all that we're talking about. We do not know what will be the result of the investigation. But insofar as the power of the president is concerned, he can do so without the need of concurrence of the Senate. As Soljan Guevara himself said, whether or not we will respect the conclusions of the investigating body is another point. That's correct. We need not concur with it because we have our own system. But that is a matter that we cannot control. And because the prerogative of the president is simply limited to whether or not to allow ICC investigators to come in. And at that point, the judgment of the president is superior. You cannot stop the president from saying, I want the ICC investigators to come in. Whether or not the Philippines will respect the findings of the ICC investigator are completely different. It's a completely different matter.
Okay. My last question is the Supreme Court decision. I find that quite interesting that what you said, the Supreme Court said, to withdraw from a treaty is purely an executive decision. And this could be worrisome. Let's talk about a bigger one, the Mutual Defense Treaty, right? I mean, okay, there's the ICC, there's the Visiting Forces Agreement, but the Mutual Defense Treaty, are we saying that to withdraw from the Mutual Defense Treaty technically is in the hands of one person at this point? I mean, yes. Regardless who it is, are we seeing that, Senator?
That's the reality in international politics, because you cannot make the decision of the executive always subject to the concurrence of the legislative branch or of the Supreme Court, because then by the very nature of foreign relations, you must consider the relationship between in the international community of the country. So the decision of the Supreme Court stands. You cannot question the right of the president to withdraw from a treaty as they have decided. Neither, therefore, as following the same logic, neither would you have the basis to question the re-entry or the adherence again to an international statute without the concurrence of the Senate. That's very clear in my mind. And as I said, there are precedents already. Precedence in the Visiting Forces Agreement, and precisely because of what you have stated, Karen. After the Supreme Court decision, what I did was to insert a clause in all the ratifications of treaties that the executive may not withdraw from this treaty without the concurrence of the Senate. Absent that provision, in all the past treaties that we signed, the Supreme Court has recognized the right of the president to withdraw from the treaty as a matter of executive action, because that is the nature of the political setup. The president is the prime architect of our foreign policy. Without the interference of the legislature, except in the budget, in the matter of the confirmation of the ambassadors, and number three, concurrence in the treaties. Other than this, foreign relations is best left to the judgment of the president and ordering the Supreme Court.
All right. On that note, I want to thank you so much for this discussion, former Senate President Franklin Drilon. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Karen. Thank you for having me again.